Since 1990, our next speaker, Randy Bias, has driven innovations in infrastructure, IT, and 24/7 service delivery. He's the CTO and founder of Cloudscaling. He's led open source licensing of GoGrid's API, which is very influential. It influenced both Rackspace as well as Sun Microsystems, VMware, and others. He was a leader in the effort in the organization that helped deliver the largest cloud infrastructure in Asia. And I'd also urge you to go to cloudscaling.com and subscribe to his blog, which is quite controversial at times, but always a good read. So without further ado, the founder and CTO of Cloudscaling, Randy Bias.
Good morning. Thanks for having me. I'm going to try to be as exciting, as dynamic as I can be on 3 hours of sleep. It's not going to be that dynamic, but we'll see. Thanks to Evan and the rest of the NextNet folks for having me here. The original name for this title was Designing Public and Private Clouds, and that's largely what we're going to talk about, but more with a focus on storage, since it's the Open Storage Summit. I thought that made sense, so hopefully you'll be patient. There's my Twitter handle if you want to badmouth me or give me props, I'll just jump into it. So this is basically going to be a story in three parts. In the first, I'm going to do a little bit of level setting and basically talk about sort of the way that we see that cloud computing systems are being built, the two different ways. In the second, I'm going to talk about how that affects storage. And in the third, I'm going to sort of talk about what I think the future of cloud storage looks like. So if you look right now at the way that people are building storage clouds, there's really two key approaches. There's sort of this scale-out or elastic approach, which is really sort of the canonical cloud there is Amazon Web Services. And then there's what I think of as sort of the enterprise cloud or enterprise virtualization approach. And that's sort of more that VMware vBlock, vCVBlock, VMware-based kind of deployments. And these are two very different kinds of architectures. And the reason is that they focus on two completely different types of applications. Amazon has grown from, handfuls of VMs to something like 1 million virtual machines under management in 5 years' time. And they've done that predominantly off of new applications. And so that unlocking of new capabilities is largely what's driven their growth, and that's the new sort of emerging paradigm. That's where kind of the puck is going, right? Skate to where the puck is. And Amazon's really showing us that path. And that's very different than what enterprise clouds are focused on, which is the existing applications in the enterprise data center, cost optimizing them, making them a little cheaper, replacing the EMC box with a NextNet store box, that kind of thing. So when I think about cloud computing, I think about it as a fundamental disruption. And this is why there's these two different approaches to building clouds that we see out there. And what I mean by a fundamental disruption is that, only a few times in history do we see sort of the entire information technology stack being rethought. And if you look at Amazon Web Services, you look at Amazon.com even, or Google, or Facebook, or you look at any of the large internet scale businesses, and they don't build anything like a typical enterprise does. The applications aren't architected the same, the networks aren't architected the same, the storage isn't architected the same, the data center isn't architected the same. The way that the operators function, the way the developers function is 100% different. It is a completely different model. And that model is starting to drive down into the mainstream. Evan mentioned the elephant in the room, Hadoop, earlier. What is Hadoop? Hadoop is an open source project that allows everybody to have Google's MapReduce technology. What is Cassandra? Cassandra is another open source project that allows everybody to have Google's Bigtable technology. So in a way, there's sort of this general trend across the entire information technology stack, from the concrete, how we build the data centers, all the way up through the application, that's fundamentally being rethought. And I don't think this is the first time this has happened. So if we look back in time, what we're really seeing now is that cloud computing, the sort of new IT paradigm, is starting to displace enterprise computing in the same way that enterprise computing displaced mainframe computing. And that's the kind of transition we're looking at. And when we look back and we see what sort of happened in that very first transition before businesses really used computing technology in order to get a competitive advantage, when those first computers came along, big box mainframes, it actually really changed the game. So a company like American Airlines was very successful in the 60s with deploying the first electronic reservation system called Sabre. And that was all done on a mainframe in conjunction with IBM and allowed American Airlines to dominate the airline industry from the 60s into the late 70s, right? They had a computer, nobody else had a computer. As we moved into the 80s, that's where sort of I think of as, you know, client-server enterprise computing started to arise. And we moved from this model where you had one big box of metal in the data center that was running a single application or a handful of applications into a model where some of the compute was in the data center, some of the compute was on your desktop, and you know things started to fundamentally change. There was a rethink of the network, there was a rethink of the application stack, and you know everything was basically put sort of into turmoil. And during these kinds of transitions, when you see a disruption like this, you notice that all the vendors change. And this is what we see happening with Nexenta, you know, against kind of the traditional enterprise vendors today. But you know, I think that that's just a small part of a general trend that's happening across the board. That's a lot more than just storage. So we're entering into this third phase. There's all these new vendors. They're tackling all the different parts of the IT stack. They're you know really trying to, you know, disrupt the incumbents, and that's really where we are today. And so, you know, some people will look at cloud computing and they see it as VMs on demand or hosting, or they see it as, you know, kind of, you know, running your data center. I would suggest that cloud computing is something new, which is this fundamental rethink of the information technology stack. And that's what cloud computing is, and that's why it's important, and that's why we're seeing so much opportunity. So if we just try to take this a little bit deeper and say, okay, well, that makes a little bit of sense, Randy. I mean, you know, I get it. The IT stack's changing, it's being disrupted. You know, can we look at an emerging pattern? And I think we can, which is that if we take some of the elements of IT shown here on the left, some of the ways that we measure it and sort of understand it, and we look at it, you know, there's this very clear transition as we move from mainframe to enterprise to cloud computing in terms of the way that we think about these approaches. Somebody like Google is running completely on commodity hardware, and with something like 5 to 10, maybe sometimes 15% of that commodity hardware failed at any given time without any service level impact. And this is very different from an enterprise data center. Most enterprise data centers do everything they can to make sure that nothing ever fails, right? So it's a very different model. It's a very different way of thinking. If you go even further back and you look at Tandem, their mainframes were called nonstop computing. That was their whole shtick at the time, nonstop computing. Some of those mainframes were up for 10 years at a time through hardware and operating system upgrades. I mean, can you imagine a system where you could upgrade the entire operating system without taking it down? I mean, people went to extreme amounts of effort to try to make sure everything was up all the time, and we've really changed that model. Folks like Amazon and Google and Facebook, they just assume things are going to fail. That design for failure model. They assume it's going to fail, they plan for it, and then make sure that there's some kind of graceful degradation so that the system continues to operate in some function, so it's always on. It might have a partial outage, a partial failure, but the system is always on. I am getting to storage. So, when you look at enterprise computing today, and what's really typical is that a new application comes into the enterprise data center, and we go through this process. I sort of think about it as the assembly line model for information technology. And the process is this. The app comes in, and then we say, what are the requirements for the app? What kind of network does it need? What kind of storage does it need? What kind of servers does it need? What kind of databases does it need? And then it goes on the assembly line. The network guys provision the network. Server guys provision the servers, storage guys do storage, and so on and so on and so on, until you come out the other end and you've got this application that's running on its own custom infrastructure. So it's a silo. It's a complete stack all the way down. And so you get no leverage, you get no economies of scale. Every application in the enterprise data center is basically bespoke. All the infrastructure that supports it is bespoke. And this is a very different model to cloud computing or the way somebody like these internet scale providers operate, which is that they have more of a layer cake. Somebody like Google has a next-gen data center. They have all commodity hardware. Then they run Google FS, which is their storage layer. Then they run Bigtable on top of that, which is their columnar database. Then they run MapReduce on top of that, which is their compute. And then each of their applications runs on that same homogeneous layer cake. And that's how they get economies of scale. So it's more, you know, that's more what I think of as sort of the robotics factory model for information technology, right? You know, the system is always the same, and if you need to put another car through it, you just reprogram the robots. So if you look at what's there right now, there's a whole bunch of solutions in the lower left that are supporting these existing enterprise applications. But there haven't been solutions that have been able to support these scale-out applications. And these scale-out applications have unique requirements. You know, they're big data, they're mobile, they're apps. A lot of the time, they are new applications that are being designed to plug into something like Facebook, or iOS, or Android. And the problem is if you plug into one of those very large platforms, just like when you plug into the internet and you bring up a web application, you can go from having, you know, tens of users one day to millions the next day to tens of millions the day after that to hundreds of millions the day after that. So one of the canonical use cases for Amazon Web Services in the early days was a startup in the US called Animoto who had to scale from a handful of servers to 4,000 virtual servers on Amazon Web Services in 30 days. I mean, you can't rack and stack 4,000 servers as a five-person startup in 30 days. It's just not possible, right? And so that's part of what is happening here. We've got a new set of capabilities, a new set of applications that are basically have some kind of dynamism to them. They're elastic, they scale out, and then we need infrastructure that supports them. And so these public providers are the ones that have been successful so far in doing that. Now, while a lot of this has really started in the public cloud space, a lot of those technologies that allow building scale-out clouds and supporting scale-out applications are now available. Folks like Nexenta, of course, obviously, technologies like OpenStack, Arista, Eucalyptus, a lot of these open source or more open systems are focused on, or are at least partially focused on, these scale-out applications and this next-generation infrastructure. So, you know, again, a scale-out cloud looks like Amazon. So what does that mean? So the first thing is that failure domains are much smaller. And this is something, as we start to get into the meat of this presentation, where I think it's going to maybe challenge some of the perceptions you have about the way to deploy, build, and architect storage, because my opinions are probably very different from yours. Another big part of this is, you know, that sort of design for failure model. Google and Amazon and Facebook, they all know because they're operating at a certain scale that hardware is always unreliable at that scale. It always fails somewhere, it fails. There is no way to make hardware 100% uptime. So they simply accept that risk and plan for it. Scaling out, obviously. And then the other big thing here that I think is going to challenge people's perceptions is that, you know, the apps are beginning to manage the infrastructure and manage the complexity. The app knows where its data is. The app knows what its servers are. It knows when its servers fail. It knows when its storage fails. It's handling more of the complexity. It's doing things like auto-scaling, right? Auto-scaling is not possible unless the application knows what the infrastructure looks like and is controlling and managing it, right? It's totally impossible without that. And once it's doing that, it's less important for the infrastructure to be smart about managing when servers fail or when storage fails. So failure domains, I'm not sure everybody really thinks about these very much. A potential customer I was talking to recently had the best explanation for this. They called it the blast radius. That means when something blows up, what does it impact, right? If it impacts a lot of things, that's a large failure domain. If it impacts a very small number of things, that's a small failure domain. And so you can see this with SANs. SANs are typically deployed. Now, I'm not saying Nexent in particular. I'm talking tends to be the big box guys. They tend to be deployed in very monolithic, you know, scale-up kind of approaches. So I guess I'm not constrained. I'll name names. The EMC CX4960 is a four-rack deployment, right? It's 1,000 spindles, right? If you have a 10-to-1 ratio of VMs to that and it blows up, you've impacted 10,000 VMs. That's bigger than most clouds that are running today, right? I mean, that is a huge blast radius, right? So if you look back, there are a couple of very public failures, one with FlexiScale in the UK in 2007 when they were down for 24 hours, and one with UOL Brazil just last year where they were down for 3 days. And in the FlexiScale case, what happened is they had two HA boxes, you know, traditional SAN. You know, it was great. It was running. Everything was wonderful. And then the operator made a mistake on the configuration and zeroed it on the primary, and it was auto-synchronized a null configuration to the secondary. Bam, gone. Entire configuration of the SAN gone. They spent 24 hours recovering it, and they were hosed. The entire cloud was basically out of commission. The entire cloud was dependent on two boxes. The reality is that HA pairs, you know, which is a traditional pattern for enterprise computing, work great until they don't work, and then they fail really spectacularly. And a lot of the time, people tend to make the blast radius on them very, very large. UOL Brazil was similar. They're running, you know, several thousand VMs in their public cloud. They're running all direct attached storage. Somebody had the great idea, let's move to a SAN. So they moved to a SAN, and within a few months of making that transition to a SAN, they had another similar problem, which I'm not allowed to talk about in technical detail. But they had a similar problem to FlexiScale, where they basically blew away and corrupted the data in their enterprise vendor SAN. And it took them 3 days to restore everything from backups. And this is just the public stuff. So, you know, big failure domains are bad, in my opinion. So again, there's these two different architectures for clouds. They support two different kinds of applications. And what we really see is that while there's some overlap, you see some scale out inside of enterprise computing systems. You see some kind of scale up, you know, in sort of the scale out clouds. I mean, there's, you know, it's a bit of a Venn diagram as shown here. But the reality is that there's these two basic poles, and it seems to be that all the new stuff is really happening here in the upper right, where the app's managing the complexity, and it's about this scale-out model. And so that means that storage architectures are changing, and I think you've already seen some of this probably in some of the work that you're doing either at Nexenta or as a partner of Nexenta, and that you see that some of these architectures are changing, and people are starting to think differently about this. So if you look at this as a continuum, and we're sort of moving from kind of the classic storage model towards the scale-out storage model over some period of time, and that's supporting these two different types of cloud architectures, it's important to recognize that people are moving from, you know, uptime in the infrastructure to uptime in the app, and part of what that means is that the amount of redundancy that you need in every single hardware component is different. I mean, how many people have seen the Google, you know, racks of servers? That few? I'm surprised. So Google has these racks of servers they like to show that are basically, you know, there's no metal. It's basically a motherboard on sort of like a piece of cork or cardboard that's jammed into the rack. You know, there's a couple of disk drives on it, and that's their de facto standard for compute, right? There's no redundant power supplies. There's no redundant networking. You know, it's very minimal, and that's part of the reason why their cost structure is so low. And part of the reason they can do that is that the app itself, the software that they write that runs on top of this commodity hardware, basically is handling all the redundancy. The redundancy is not in the hardware, it's in the app. So that also means that sort of what I think of as the storage tiers is changing quite a bit. And this is my view of what the storage tiers are. I'm sure people have different views. But you've kind of got, you know, number one, which is sort of these mission-critical apps that's very expensive, supports mission-critical apps that's very expensive. Right now, in sort of that classic storage model, it's all these high-speed spindles or SSDs. It's usually SAN. Sometimes it's NAS. But what we're seeing is this move in these scale-out architectures towards this abstraction around SANs. You know, if you look at Amazon Web Services and their Elastic Block Storage, which we're going to talk about a little bit later, you know, it's a very different model for a SAN. And that's part of the reason they don't call it a SAN, because expectations change. Instead, it's sort of on-demand block devices with a sort of SAN behind it. Perhaps more interesting is that there's been this release by Amazon Web Services of something called DynamoDB, which is an on-demand columnar database that looks a lot like Bigtable or, to some degree, Amazon's S3 Dynamo technology. But it's an on-demand NoSQL database that's supported 100% by SSDs. And so they're providing that to the customer, so the customers now no longer have to manage their database or their storage, and they get very high IOPS. And so you're going to see a lot more of these higher-level abstractions that are kind of for Tier 1 mission-critical applications. Tier 2, you know, I think that's pretty clear. You know, that's really seems to be moving more towards direct attached storage in these scale out clouds. And I think in that case, people are choosing to take that direct attached storage and layer something on top of it. Sometimes it's NAS or NFS or something like that, and they're running it sort of at the virtualization layer, not the physical layer. Sometimes it's some of these new distributed file system technologies, and sometimes it's the application like Hadoop or Cassandra that's actually managing the storage, the DAS on behalf. But it's really, there's, you know, move away from network-attached storage or NFS because it doesn't scale out well. I mean, it just doesn't. I'm happy to argue that with anybody. And I love NFS, okay, so don't get me wrong. And then finally, there seems to be a move away from tape and nearline disk towards these object storage systems, which are very well designed for this kind of approach. If you look at Amazon Web Services S3 and the phenomenal growth it's had, or Swift, which is the object storage for OpenStack, one of the things you'll notice is that, you know, there's just a very large uptake. And the reason is it's just very, very easy to use this as sort of archives and backups in Nearline, because it scales out. These object storage systems wind up being these big dumping grounds. You don't even think about it. You just throw stuff in there and sort of like forget about it until you need it. And that's the hope. I think that's going to bite some people in the behind later on, and it'll have its own kinds of problems, but you're seeing more and more of that becoming the de facto kind of tier three. So again, in these scale-out systems, you know, the data management's moving into the application, and if you look at these three open source projects as sort of being representative of what's happening as a whole, you get some kind of flavor of where it's going. You've got technology like Reoc, which is an implementation of AWS's Dynamo technology, the same technology behind their object storage, or S3, and they provide sort of the scale-out distributed data store. You've got Hadoop with HDFS, which is doing distributed storage with computation on top of it, and then Cassandra with Bigtable. And all three of these manage their own storage. They don't need RAID. They don't need expensive servers. They largely don't need SSD caches. You know, so you see just a very different way of thinking about this. It's moving up the stack. So this is going to be the fun one to talk about. So Netflix, who is the largest video on demand streaming service in the world, who moved from running their own classic enterprise computing style system in their own data centers to Amazon Web Services, did this test around Cassandra. And it's interesting, you know, their whole use case, I don't know if folks are familiar with them, but they were running IBM servers and Oracle databases and, you know, Sun storage and, you know, the whole typical kind of like, you know, enterprise stack, and they moved away from the entire stack onto Amazon Web Services. And they did that because they simply didn't know how fast they were going to grow, and they thought that provisioning new data centers and storage and compute and network and all that good stuff would basically slow them down. And so they re-architected their application to scale out. And as a side benefit, once they did that and they were successful in the US, all they had to do in order to go into the European Union market was basically flip the switch and start deploying into Amazon Web Services availability zone in Ireland. I mean, no data center contracts, no CapEx expenditure, so on and so on. They did the same when they went to Latin America. So you're going to see a lot more of this kind of escalating as people realize the flexibility they get from public clouds. But getting to the case, What Netflix did is they took Cassandra, which is this columnar database technology, and they basically deployed it on Amazon Web Services in a variety of different sizes, 50 nodes, 100 nodes, 150, and 300, and then ran some tests. And in their testing, they essentially scaled linearly. From 50 to 300 nodes, they got the exact same performance. It scaled up linearly with the number of nodes. Twice as many nodes, twice as much performance. So they got to the point where they were able to get a million writes a second with triple redundancy, with triple replication. So that's pretty phenomenal, right? What's interesting about it is that, you know, they could basically dial it up or down as needed to be on that cloud. And that's the most powerful thing about it. They don't have to predict in advance how much storage they need or how much database throughput they need. And if you looked at each of the nodes in that system, basically they had the same amount of performance in each case, and they're all using direct attached storage. So whether it was 50 nodes or 300 nodes, they were getting the same amount of throughput and performance from each node, the same amount of utilization. So that's pretty phenomenal. And this is all with direct attached storage, right? No, nothing fancy here of any kind, right? No tricks. And so that's powerful because, you know, from a time and an opportunity perspective, you know, basically this whole thing was managed by the application. It was all on demand. And if you look at the cost, I mean, yeah, you know, you can take an Accenture store and get way under $4 a gig a month. But the reality is that, you know, $4 a gig a month is way under what an enterprise, a lot of enterprise vendors, you know, big box vendors will basically charge you for just the storage, right? And you look at an EMC and some of those more expensive solutions, and they're going to be, you know, I think I heard from one medical provider in the U.S. that they were upwards of, you know, $9 to $10 per gig per month when you actually did the numbers, which is ridiculous. But in this case, that number of $4 a month, that includes the cost of the storage admins, the network infrastructure, the storage, the databases, everything. That's a whole lock, stock, and barrel kind of number. And, you know, that's pretty compelling if you look at that, look at it from that perspective. So we've got these two cloud types, enterprise, scale out. They're impacting storage and the way that we think about it. You know, a lot of things are moving up into the application. So what does that mean for us as a community? Well, I don't know, right? I mean, I really can't predict the future. I like to think I can sometimes. I like to convince myself that I can, but I'm wrong as often as I am right. The thing that we know, because it's a disruption and because things are moving very fast, is that change is certain and that a lot of things are up in the air and we don't know where everything's going to settle. So what I can tell you is what I see people actually deploying right now and being successful with, at least on scale-out clouds. And so this is a short list, and we're just going to go through it fairly quickly, and then I'll be able to take some questions. So the first thing I wanted to talk about is our first attempt to try to figure out how to scale out SANs. And what that was is that at Korea Telecom, KT, we decided that, you know, direct attached storage wasn't quite what we needed, and SANs had too big a blast radius, so we tried to do something clever, or we thought we were clever at the time, which is we tried to have a little in-rack SAN, or technically there were two, in every rack, and basically scale the SAN out using an Accenture store. They weren't tied together, they were just individual little islands, there was no redundancy. In a way, it was like we took the DAS right out of the nodes in the rack, and you can see there are 1U nodes there. And we basically took it out, and we connected it via high-speed networking, and we basically ran it separate so we could get some economies of scale, use SSD caching in Accenture stores and all that. Blazing fast, ridiculous, as fast as a local RAID. The problem was that the customers didn't really get it, right? So when they heard SAN, they expected, you know, kind of like EMC style, you know, everything's redundant, you know, everything's replicated, et cetera, et cetera. But they didn't understand that they had to pay for that, right? I mean, that's not free. And so this model worked out from a performance and throughput point of view, and it was very good if you were comfortable with having the apps manage the data. But it didn't really work out if you wanted to put traditional enterprise applications on this. Another way of thinking about scale-out SANs is the way basically the EBS does it. So this is a little bit of a complicated diagram. I apologize for that. It was done at about 1 a.m. last night when I couldn't sleep. The green racks on the side basically are EBS racks, and this is how Amazon does it. They have racks just for elastic block storage. And in those racks, they're sort of sub-racks or sub-clusters, you can think of them as, which are groups of servers that are serving up block storage. And believe it or not, they're using GNBD. They're not using iSCSI or AOE or anything funky like that. They're using the GNBD driver. They do some replication between the clusters. And then those, when somebody makes an API call, those, a new volume is allocated, a new block device is allocated off of one of the EBS clusters and then attached to our virtual machine from the back end through the hypervisor. And that's how EBS works. But what's interesting about this is that EBS uses a scheduler. And it's a scheduler like you would think of as an HPC scheduler. And it's the same kind of scheduler that you see used for compute. So if you look at all the compute systems that manage virtual machines on demand, whether it's CloudStack or OpenStack or things like this, what happens is when you request a virtual machine, it allocates a virtual machine somewhere in the cloud and it tries to be smart. It tries to spread customers' virtual machines across as many physical nodes as possible. That way, if a physical node goes away, that failure domain is relatively small and only one, or a few VMs for any given customer are impacted. So the scheduler takes the job of sort of distributing the resource request across the pool of resources in a relatively smart way. And that's what EBS does. All of these little SANs, these little storage area networks, are these little teeny clusters that, I'm pretty sure that the initial EBS is even just using 1 gig networking and maybe as few as 8 to 12 disks in a node. But then the scheduler is smart enough to allocate all the new volumes for one given customer across as many of those cluster nodes as possible. And what that means is that if any of those EBS clusters go down, then you're only likely to use a volume or two. So if you just apply RAID inside of your virtual machine on top of that, then you're going to see very high uptimes. And this is the way EBS works today, and I think you're going to see more and more of these sort of block device services in the future. So I don't know how familiar everybody is with Hadoop. Evan seemed to make a joke about it. For those who aren't familiar, it's really simple. You take a chunk of data, you cut it up into a lot of pieces, you throw it out across a cluster of some number of machines, and then you run an algorithm on it. You get the results back, you collate them together. So you map, basically, the problem across n nodes, and then you reduce it back and you compose it. And then you can, you can take big problems like video transcoding or other problems like that and basically run them computationally. So it turns out that technology also works well for building distributed file systems. So Hadoop comes with something called the Hadoop Distributed File System. And it does a lot of these things that traditionally happen in the storage layer. It does replication, it does data rebalancing, it handles disk and server failures, it's meant to run on commodity servers, it's not meant to use RAID, just like ZFS. It has some awareness of locality in the rack, so it knows to do replication in rack and out of rack if you tell it to do the right thing. And it does some basic checksums. So this is interesting, because this is at the application layer, right? Again, a lot of the heavy lifting is being moved into these apps that are sort of understanding what the hardware looks like well enough to do a lot of the right things. There's another alternative to HDFS called Ceph, and there's also Gluster. There's a whole bunch of these. You'll notice that they have basically the same kind of approach. There's metadata, and then the blocks are and the storage is allocated across a cluster. What's funny about this is that this is the same architecture as Lustre, basically. So it's, a 10-year-old kind of architecture right now, which is good and bad. The problem with distributed file systems, everybody has a hard-on about them because they're scale-out. I didn't mean to quite be that that bold. But everybody is sort of excited about these because they're scale-out kind of technology, right? You add more and more racks and nodes and servers and get more and more throughput, and that's great. And you also make the blast radius freaking huge, right? That's the problem, right? If you've got 10 racks all running distributed file system technology and there's a bug that causes corruption and it goes through all 10 racks, you got a freaking gigantic problem, right? And so this is something that I don't think people are really thinking about, which is that we all know, we've all seen hardware fail, we've all seen software fail. So these failure domains, these aren't a joke. These are a very important thing to internalize and understand when designing sort of a scale-up model, as you're trying to reduce the blast radius when things blow up. Either that or you're looking for a new job. So you've got sort of, you know, another model here that people are doing sort of more at the virtualization layer, but again, using direct attached storage is just doing replication in the databases. I mean, this seems obvious, right? I mean, everybody's doing replication in their databases, but it actually turns out that in a lot of enterprise data centers, tons and tons and tons of databases, some of them mission critical, do not have a backup. They do not have a master-master or master-slave active-passive, active-active setup at all. Right? They fundamentally rely on the infrastructure to be there all the time. They rely on the storage not to fail, the servers not to fail, and the networking not to fail. And of course, those all fail at some point. So not to make a terrible fun, but it seems like since everything's failing, it seems like a failed strategy to me. Object storage, you know, if you take it and you really simplify it, all object storage is sort of this consistent hash ring, kind of shown at the bottom there, where you've got a distributed hash table or a consistent hash table that sort of gives you an index that tells you that a given blob or file is basically located in, you know, n number locations across all your storage nodes. And that gives you sort of this algorithmic approach. And then there's a very typical 2-3-tier web, you know, front end to that that provides the API and does the ring calculations to figure out where to store the objects or to retrieve the objects from. Very, very straightforward. You know, it lacks some of the things a lot of traditional storage systems have, but, you know, it handles a lot of the basics, you know, doesn't need RAID, you know, doesn't need any kind of special disk or server, does all the replication, et cetera, et cetera. And it seems to scale really well. I'd say S3 is somewhere in the order of, it's hard to be sure, but at least, you know, half an exabyte. And that's a lot of storage in a single storage system. So if we look at sort of all these new kind of ways of thinking about storage in the context of you know, scale-out clouds or, you know, the way people are consuming and using scale-out clouds, you know, kind of shown here on the left, each of the ones I've gone through, you see that there's some commonality, which I'm going to talk about on the next slide, which is it really comes down to, you know, are you going to kind of do that scale-out SAN model, or are you going to have the best direct attached storage there is? And the great news about that is I think ZFS can do both of those very, very well. Probably not a lot here to harp on too much, except to maybe call out on the distributed file system stuff where I kind of say you can run at the physical or virtual layer. I think at the physical layer, distributed file systems are probably a terrible idea because of the blast radius issue. But at the virtual layer, you know, if you're running them inside of a single application, you know, running Ceph, you know, inside of each of a bunch of virtual machines and getting sort of a scale out distributed file system seems like a great approach for a lot of different kinds of problems that may need to get solved. So where's ZFS value? I mean, again, you know, it probably sounds silly, but the data integrity issue is real. If you look at the numbers that Google has around the kinds of bit rot problems they have over a long period of time with lots of spindles, you know, it really adds up. I mean, basically, spinning media degrades over time, and SSDs degrade even faster. And so you've got to constantly be looking at the data and making sure that it's still what you lay down. And ZFS does a lot of the heavy lifting there, and there's still a lot of value. I don't think that that's a forever thing. ButterFS is building in checksumming. You know, other people are going to get there. One of the other big things about ZFS is that it scales down because it's open source, and because the companies that are building products and technology around it, like Nexenta, don't have, you know, legacy, you know, sales forces and technology in place. It means that they don't have sort of skin in the game to sell a big box solution. Right? I mean, one of the problems I heard from the EMC guys is that they acquired Isilon, which is this scale-out NAS technology, and their sales guys don't know how to sell it. It's lower margin, lower price point, and basically the sales guys just are comfortable selling more VMAXs. VMAXs net them, you know, a bigger commission, right? And so there's an inherent conflict there. And so these SAN and NAS solutions, they don't really scale down, but Nexenta Store or ZFS can scale down. You can run it on 6 USB drives attached to a laptop, right? I mean, you know, that actually means that if you want to do more of that scale-out model, you've got a lot more tools. And obviously, the whole commodity x86 server winning kind of gets you there. So before I take questions, you know, you got to build the right cloud. You got to figure out, are you building for enterprises or are you building for scale out? I realize most people are probably still looking at a lot of enterprise problems. I think you're going to see more and more of the scale up problems. You're going to see them in things like big data, probably before you'll see them maybe in some of the hosting providers, but you will see them. And you're going to want the right storage that suits whatever kind of cloud you're trying to deploy. In some cases, you can put those together. You can have kind of enterprise and you know, scale out in the same kind of cloud, right? I mean, it takes some forethought. You got to think about it. You got to plan it, but it is doable. Questions? I have to take at least three before I can let you go. No previews on the Thank panel you. Later, okay?
Thank you. Yeah. What are you talking about? No, can you talk a little bit about the operational discipline or the, you know, effectively at the end of one of your slides, you said, provided you do it right. And obviously, that's what you do. So, but without summarizing, you know, could you just quickly summarize, what do you mean by doing it right when you're architecting and building these clouds?
I mean, that's a whole nother presentation. I got to pick what I can do in 45 minutes. How would I nutshell it? Well, operators are the biggest source of problems. So you want to eliminate them completely from the picture as much as possible, at least from the hands-on stuff. That doesn't mean there aren't people involved with the architecture and building the tooling around doing automation. But I mean, the reality is that is the bigger the system gets, the more likely it is that human beings will make the mistakes, right? And it's not that automation won't make mistakes, but it'll make mistakes in sort of usually more predictable ways. So, you know, figuring out how to do automation around a lot of these storage systems and how they're deployed and managed is really important. A big part of it from my perspective is really the architecture stuff. So I think you have to think in very different ways. Like this whole issue around failure domains, I really, you know, I kind of expounded on that a lot, but there are other similar kinds of notions when you're thinking about larger scale systems that are really important to sort of internalize and think about. One of the things I've seen that's a problem for a lot of engineers is that they want to solve complex problems by adding more parts, more things. And every new thing you add is a new thing that can fail. It's a new thing that has to be managed. It's a new thing that, you know, that you have to pay for. You know, a hammer is a hammer, and the reason a hammer doesn't fail very much is it's a piece of wood with a big slab of metal on the end, and there's only two pieces. Right? I mean, it just can't really fail in many different ways. It's not very exotic. And so I think, you know, a lot of the architecture and engineering you see at the internet scale players is, you know, this sort of focus on ruthless simplicity. This is some of the things you and I have not seen quite eye to eye on. But I think that's part of this notion of having, you know, really refocusing on direct attached storage and having CNs be smaller. Like it, people look at that and they're like, well, direct attached storage, I mean, God, isn't that from the 80s? Yeah, it's from the 80s, right? And it works, and it's really solid. And, you know, everybody knows how to make, you know, put disk in an x86 server and make it work, right? My mother can do it, right? SANs are something else completely. I mean, who here thinks Fibre Channel has a future? Nobody's going to stand up for, oh, we got one, right? I mean, Fibre Channel has no future because it's another kind of networking technology that requires another kind of training, another kind of admin, another kind of complexity. I mean, you know, that stuff always loses. And I think more and more we're seeing that the bigger it gets, the bigger a system gets, the simpler it has to be. So, you know, so those are a few of the things. And, you know, if you really wanted to, like, know a little bit more about how to do it right, at Cloud Connect 2012, that's this year, right? Yes, this year. I did a whole presentation on building open clouds, and it was all architecture-based, and I focused on a whole bunch of these things like monitoring and security and things like that. And I think that's online, Cloud Connect 2012. Next question.
So you talked about the object storage for a big web application and also local storage and then replication between the application. So in the future, we will see less block storage in cloud environments, or it will remain like ABS, for example. It will be swapped out for object storage. There are a lot of developments in object storage about performance. I saw some benchmarks from some vendors that are working a lot to move big, small objects, very small objects, at a latency of storage networks.
Yeah, I mean, there's no one size fits all in storage, right? I mean, that just doesn't exist, right? I mean, one of the fundamental issues with an object storage system is that you've placed n number of replicas across a cluster, right? And so when you go to retrieve those n number of replicas, you don't know if they're in sync, you don't know if they're consistent. So you have to hopefully get more than one, right? And then you don't know if they're all available so that you can check if they're all consistent, right? So whether it's 2, 3, 4, 5, some number of replicas, right? So you've actually got a big distributed system and you're talking to it. And so there's inherently going to be latency and time to do the checksums and to do the verification. So it's very it's always going to be difficult for object storage to scale up towards tier one. I don't expect it ever to reach tier one, right? Instead, you'll see a higher order abstraction like DynamoDB running on top of SSDs, with, you know, that's providing you sort of tier one, where you're only putting certain kinds of data in it, right? It's more likely, I mean, when you go and you talk to a SAN, right, if you're looking for the replication, it's all right there on the disk in that one node, so you don't have to take that extra step. And so by that same notion, I think it's really hard to take sort of SAN technology and run object storage on top of it. It's two different approaches, and it really does fit in those kinds of tiering very naturally. And so people are going to make it faster, but they're never going to make it. You're not going to run a database on top of object storage. People have tried and failed.
Niklas Andersson, Tech World. How can you assure full redundancy between two data centers in a high availability solution if you don't use fiber channel?
So you're asking how can you do like real-time synchronous replication between two data centers?
Yeah, without using fiber channel, because you want to have a low latency.
Well, I mean, I guess my world perspective is a little bit skewed because from my world perspective, you know, that's not something you can do today. Maybe somebody claims you can, but in the United States, I'm not going to be able to run fiber channel across a wide area network from the East Coast to the West Coast and have one block in flight doing synchronous replication with a 50 millisecond lag in between. I mean, there's no way. I won't get any kind of throughput. You get 100 megs a second out of that storage system, right? That's unacceptable. So, I mean, maybe in the EU, it's easier because your data centers are not, like, you know, very far apart. But if, you know, the people that I know that do this and that do have the need for this are basically the financial services sector, and I don't really know anybody else who does. And there's a lot of other strategies that you're starting to see them, you know, employ that don't require relying on the infrastructure to do this kind of real-time synchronous replication. And in many cases, even though they put that in place, like when I talked to the Credit Suisse guys, they started out trying to do synchronous replication across fiber channel, and it didn't work. It had too large a performance impact. And so they got to a point where they simply had to turn it into asynchronous replication. And the reality is you can do asynchronous replication over all kinds of things besides fiber channel, right? Do you not buy that?
Okay, so you say it's not possible.
I think it's a fool's errand. It's an attempt to try to make sure that you've got consistency between two data centers that are geographically dispersed enough that they can't be impacted by the same catastrophic event, but that don't have the same amount of where the latency, even though they're far enough apart, the latency is not going
to
have an impact.
Yeah, I'm thinking about sites, it's up to, like, say, 100 kilometers apart.
So yeah. I mean, I don't know if you've done this, but so here's the deal, right? If you have a storage system, a single storage system, and you have a whole bunch of writes in flight to the disk drives, you can have up to 32 writes per spindle in flight going down to the disk drives. And that's why you can get something like an EMC box or an Extenda box to push 10, 20 gigabits a second out of the front end, right? And that's very valuable. Now, when you try to do synchronous replication, the problem is that in order to write one block onto the A system, you've got to write the block onto the B system first. And it's synchronous, so you can't have any more than one block in flight. So instead of having 32 times the number of spindles in flight, you've got one block in flight. And so when we tuned the hell out of it for KT in an experiment, what we found is that you could get up to 1 gig a second total throughput using synchronous replication and no more. And that's supported by, you know, even standard Ethernet. You don't have to run 10 gig E for that. So fiber channel's not really going to get you there. I mean, it's just that there's some laws of physics and there's some basic ways that storage works that just impact it, right? I mean, you've got to come up with a different strategy, you know, like a two-phase commit, you know, at the application layer in order to guarantee data consistency across data centers.
Okay, thanks.
All right. Yeah.
I was thinking about in your slide, as I've seen the Rackspace logo, and just remember that a few times ago, me and my colleagues were thinking about building an OpenStack cloud for a Nova Compute cloud, I mean. And we were considering which scale-out storage to adopt for running virtual machine on it. It was at least 1 year ago, and we had a look at Chef, Gluster, and a quick look at Sheepdog. Then we realized that the model, at least Rackspace built Nova Compute, was all around local storage. You think something has changed from in the meantime?
There are options to use non-direct attached storage with Nova. They exist. People use them. I mean, I'm not going to use anything but direct attached storage for me. I just don't think that. I mean, if you had 100 virtual machines that you're running, what percentage of those need redundant storage? Does a web app server need redundant storage? I mean, my guess is something like 10%, right? I mean, almost everybody is moving to shared nothing architecture in any kind of scale-out application, right? So the redundancy of the storage doesn't matter. Hadoop doesn't care if a virtual machine or the storage for it goes away. So, I mean, direct attached storage as a default for building a scale-out cloud is what Amazon does and what Rackspace Cloud does, and it's what OpenStack, you know, tests most thoroughly, and it makes the most sense. Now, should you run ZFS in the direct attached storage? I mean, I think there's good arguments to do that, to use a Lumos, right? But I don't know that you need anything beyond sort of a single server redundancy for the vast majority of virtual machines, and everything else could be handled through an EBS-like solution. And that's just my opinion. Lots of people will disagree with it. Bill, do you want this microphone? You have to come fight me for it.
All right, I'll fight you for it. All right, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Andy Bias, thank you very much.